A quick recap. Ares is beyond insane. Lyanna is abducted by Rhaegar. Brandon Stark storms to King's Landing with a group of other younger lords to confront Rhaegar. He doesn't find Rhaegar, only the Mad King. Ares accuses these men of plotting the murder of Rhaegar and ends up killing the boys and their fathers, including Brandon and his father, Rickard Stark, Lord of Winterfell. Ares II next commands Jon Arryn for the heads of Eddard Stark and Robert Baratheon. Jon Arryn refuses, raises up his banners in revolt, and begins the start of a rebellion that would last close to a year. Unfortunately, there isn't a lot of new information supplied by George R. R. Martin, especially in the new A World of Ice and Fire book. So a lot of this information is old, and if you've seen a Robert's Rebellion video, this information is probably all the same. We're going to talk about 10 battles in total, starting in the Vale of Arryn. Jon Arryn calls up his banners in revolt, and many answer, but not all side with Lord Arryn in the Vale. Some were very loyal to the king, including a man known as Mark Grafton. The first move of the loyalists was to block Gulltown, cutting off access to the port from the rebels. Because this port was blocked, Ned Stark had to find other means to get to the north to call his bannermen. He crossed the Mountains of the Moon to the Fingers and then found a fisherman to carry him across the Bight. While Ned made his way north, the rebels fought to take Gulltown. Once Gulltown was secured for the rebels, Robert headed to Storm's End so he could also call his bannermen. But not all of the lords in the Stormlands, just like in the Vale, agreed with the rebels and did not come to Robert's aid. Some instead stayed loyal to the king. This led to the Battle of Summerhall, which is actually three separate battles all fought in one day. The Lords Grandison, Fel, and Catherine, all loyalists, had planned to meet at Summerhall and then march on Storm's End. Luckily, Robert learned of their plans to all meet at Summerhall and decided to hit each army individually as they arrived. Lord Fel fell in battle and the rebels took his famous son, Silveraxe. Winning all three battles, Robert returns to Storm's End. And this is where Robert works his magic. In his youth, and maybe a tiny bit as his older self, Robert was very good at sweet-talking people and getting them to his side. At Storm's End, Robert convinces Lord Grandison and Lord Catherine to side with him as well as Silveraxe, even though Silveraxe's father just died trying to defeat these same rebels. With the Stormlands taken care of and united, Robert leaves his younger brother Stannis to hold Storm's End while he pushes to the west and approaches Ashford. Two theories are present why Robert fought at the Battle of Ashford. One thought is to secure the Stormlands' western flank against the Tyrells, who had a very large army. Second thought is it simply was because he got outmaneuvered by Randall Tarly and was forced to fight. A Tyrell army under the control of Lord Randall Tarly came across Robert's forces and a bloody fight ensued. The Tyrell army overran Robert's, forcing Robert to withdraw from the field before the main forces of the Tyrell host could join the battle. And this battle at Ashford was really inconclusive. Robert's forces remained mostly intact, but they were forced to start heading north to meet up with Ned Stark and Jon Arryn's army because on their own, Robert couldn't take the rest of the Tyrell forces if and when they showed up. But because of Robert's withdrawal from the Stormlands, the Tyrell army is able to lay siege on Storm's End. This siege would last close to a year, with Stannis trying to hold Storm's End. Ned Stark has reached Winterfell by this time, called his banners, and began his march south. Jon Arryn and Hoster Tully arrange a marriage between Ned and Catelyn Stark, Ned's brother Brandon's betrothed before he died. This secures an alliance and brings the Lord of Riverrun, and consequently most of the Riverlands, to the side of the rebels. King Ares II at this time is just freaking out. He believes his hand, Owen Meriwether, isn't doing his job well enough and suspects Meriwether is actually a rebel. Ares takes away Meriwether's lands, titles, and exiles him. Ares II next appoints a new hand, John Cunnington, a skilled warrior and a friend to Ares II's son, Rhaegar. At this time, Ares II is also keeping Jaime Lannister close to him at all times to use him as a possible hostage against his father, Tywin Lannister. John Cunnington, as the new hand, takes an army and goes after Robert, arriving in the Stony Sept. Robert ends up becoming wounded and hiding in the Stony Sept, while John Cunnington takes the town and searches house by house for Robert. Luckily again for Robert, Ned and Hoster Tully show up with their forces and attack the Loyalist army at the town. John Cunnington wounds Hoster Tully in the fight and kills John Arryn's cousin and last heir, Dennis Arryn, while the two armies fight in the streets and alleys. At an unknown point, Robert Baratheon comes out of hiding and leads his own attack. Eventually, John Cunnington and his army are forced to retreat. With John Arryn's last heir dead, Hoster Tully arranges a marriage between John Arryn and Lysa Tully, Catelyn Tully's younger sister. Ned marries Catelyn and John Arryn marries Lysa Tully in a double wedding. And I'm assuming Robert Baratheon was the best man. Still, not all Tully's bannermen were on board. Meanwhile, Ares II did not like the outcome at the Stony Sept, and just like with Meriwether, he ends up stripping John Cunnington of his lands and titles. Next hand of the king is Lord Carlton Chelston. Ares II's panicking is also getting a bit worse. He's starting to realize that Robert isn't a minor nuisance, but a big deal to the stability of his rule. Ares II commands pyromancers to place wildfire throughout King's Landing, even in the Red Keep. Barristan Selmy and John Derry, both Kingsguard, are sent to the Riverlands to retrieve the rest of John Cunnington's army and salvage what they can. At the same time, Lord Commander of the Kingsguard, Gerald Hightower, is sent to find Rhaegar. Eventually, Rhaegar is found and he returns to King's Landing, convincing his father to ask Tywin Lannister for help. The only thing they get in response from Casterly Rock is silence. During all this, the new hand, Sir Carlton, started investigating what all the pyromancers were up to as they were visiting the king night and day, and he was getting a little suspicious. When the Hand discovered Ares II's wildfire plot, he tries to dissuade the king from what he's planning. When he can't convince Ares II that this whole wildfire business is a terrible idea, he resigns his hand and Ares promptly burns him alive and names Rossart the new Hand of the King. The next large battle was the Battle of the Trident, where the rebel and royal forces met at the Green Fork of the Trident. Rhaegar took command of the royalist army for this battle. King Ares II also dispatched Princess Ilya's uncle, Prince Lewin Martell, of the King's Guard to take command of 10,000 Dornish troops that were marching up the King's Road to join Rhaegar's troops. Barristan Selmy and John Derry also rallied the shattered forces of John Cunnington to join Rhaegar. Rhaegar's forces numbered some 40,000, but only a tenth of that number were actual knights, while the rebels had somewhat fewer men, but they possessed people that were tested in battle, while much of Rhaegar's forces were raw and new. The two armies meet and they fight furiously. Prince Lewin Martell at one point is killed by Sir Corbray. Sir Barristan Selmy is cutting through several men but is eventually critically injured while fighting for the Royalists. And eventually, Rhaegar and Robert find each other in the battle and they begin to fight. Rhaegar manages to wound Robert, but Robert in turn deals a blow to Rhaegar's chest with his spiked hammer so hard that it kills him and sends the rubies of his armor flying into the river. Some men stopped fighting right then and there to snatch up the rubies. Most of the royal army broke and fled when Rhaegar died. With Rhaegar dead and the loyalists fleeing, this was a big win for the rebels. With the most significant loyalist army being invested in the Siege of Storm's End, the rebels had a clear path to King's Landing. Learning that the Lannister forces were moving towards King's Landing rapidly, and with Robert wounded by Rhaegar during battle, Ned Stark is left to lead the rebel army towards King's Landing, attempting to get there before the Lannisters. A really awesome moment of note, Sir Barristan Selmy, after being injured during the fight, was close to death and Roose Bolton told Robert to just end him. Robert instead spared Barristan's life and sent his own maester to heal him. So Robert may be a great many things, but this guy was pretty merciful and not a tyrant and very open-handed with people. Also, it is around this time that Robert Baratheon declared his intent to claim the throne. Maesters would justify this claim by using Robert's blood ties to House Targaryen. Robert's grandmother was the daughter of King Aegon V. This gave him a better claim to the throne, besides Aerys' children and grandchildren, than Ned Stark or Jon Arryn. But you may be asking, where are the Greyjoys? Those silly little guys that love to reave and pillage at the most inconvenient times. At first, Lord Greyjoy declared neutrality during the war. When Rhaegar was killed, Lord Greyjoy was convinced by his eldest sons, Balon, Euron, and Greyjoy, to join the rebels as soon as he could so they had a chance at the spoils of war. Not sure which side the Lannisters were on, most of the Iron Fleet had to stay at home, but Lord Greyjoy did lead 50 longships into attacking the Reach. They captured some ships, raided some towns and villages, but the longships of Shield Islands intercepted the Greyjoy fleet at Mander and slew Lord Greyjoy in battle. His heir, Balon, led the remaining fleet back to the Iron Islands and basically accomplished not much of anything. Good job, Greyjoys. This is the last major battle of the war. Tywin's forces arrive at King's Landing, claiming loyalty to Ares II and asking to be let in. Grand Maester Pycelle urges Ares II to let Tywin Lannister and his forces in, but Varys warns him that this is a trap and Tywin is not his friend. Ares II listens to Maester Pycelle, lets the Lannister forces in, and they quickly turn on Ares II and sack the city in Robert's name. At this moment, Ares II realizes that he is completely screwed, and he orders his hand, Rossart, to ignite the wildfire throughout the city. Ares II orders Jaime Lannister, the last Kingsguard in the city, to kill his father Tywin. Jaime instead kills Rossart and murders Ares II in the throne room. Jaime sits on the Iron Throne and waits. Gregor Clegane and Armory Lurch enter Maegar's Holdfast and take care of the rest of the royal family. Gregor kills Prince Aegon Targaryen, Rhaegar's son and heir, in front of Princess Ilya. He then rapes and murders Ilya with Aegon's blood and brains still on his hands. Amori drags Princess Rhaenys Targaryen from under her father's bed and kills her, stabbing her 100 times. Ned arrives in the throne room to see Jaime on the Iron Throne and Aerys II's corpse below it. Jaime tells Ned he was simply keeping it warm for him. Robert Baratheon arrives sometime later to the city, where Tywin presents the bodies of Ilya, Aegon, and Rhaenys. Robert is pleased, but Ned is disgusted by the act of murdering children. Ned and Robert argue, with Ned finally riding out of King's Landing to finish the war in the south. Mace Tyrell's forces are still outside Storm's End, where they have been for almost the entire war. Stannis and his men starve inside the walls while Mace and his men feast outside. Davos Seaworth eventually smuggles a cargo of onions past the blockade, saving Stannis and his men from starving and earning Davos the name the Onion Knight. Stark and his forces eventually arrive and they lift the siege when Tyrell quickly dips his banners. Ned next heads to the Tower of Joy with 6 companions, including Helen Reed, to rescue his sister, Lyanna Stark. Sir Arthur Dayne, Sir Oswald Wendt, and Lord Commander of the King's Guard, Gerald Hightower, are found guarding the Tower of Joy. The 7 men fight the 3 King's Guard, with only Ned and Holland surviving. Lyanna Stark is found in the tower, dying shortly after Ned's arrival after forcing him to promise something. Ned eventually tears down the tower and rides to Starfall to deliver Arthur Dayne's sword, Dawn, to his sister. The last fight is an assault on Dragonstone, where Queen Rhalla, pregnant, and her son Viserys had been sent after the Battle of the Trident. Viserys is crowned by his mother, and Stannis begins to construct a fleet to attack Dragonstone. 9 months after going to Dragonstone, Queen Rhalla dies in childbirth, bringing Daenerys Targaryen into the world, while a great storm rages around them and destroys the Targaryen fleet at anchor. Most of Dragonstone's household was willing to sell out Daenerys and Viserys to the rebels, but William Dary, Red Keep's master at arms, who went with them to Dragonstone, ends up smuggling Viserys and Daenerys out and sailing them to Braavos. This is where Viserys and Daenerys would begin their lives in exile. Stannis then successfully assaults Dragonstone. With the wars won, Robert Baratheon sits on the Iron Throne with Jon Arryn as his hand. The death of Lyanna Stark reconciles Robert and Ned. Jon convinces Robert to marry Cersei Lannister to bind the Lannisters to their side. Some rumors stir in Dorne about rebellion, especially with the death of Ilya and her children, but Jon Arryn goes to Dorne a year after the rebellion and peace is found. And thus begins the, kind of, glorious reign of King Robert Baratheon I.